Hello everyone. In this video of real-time system concepts, we will discuss various concepts like deadlock, clock tick, memory requirement, and the advantages and disadvantages of real-time kernels. So let us begin with the outcomes, learning outcomes. After completing this session, student will be able to demonstrate concept of deadlock, clock tick, and memory requirement. We will cover the advantages and disadvantages also. Let us start from deadlock. What is deadlock? So a deadlock, also called a deadly embrace. So it is a situation in which two tasks are each unknowingly waiting for resources held by the other task. So let us take one example. Assume task 1 has exclusive access to resource 1. And the task 2 has access to resource 2. So task 1 having access to resource 1, and again task 2 is having access to resource 2. Now if task 1, that is T1, needs exclusive access to R2, means if T1 needs R2 access and T2 needs R1 access, so from task 1 and task 2, both cannot be continued. So this situation is called as deadlock. So they are called deadlock. Now, how to avoid deadlock? So these are there are various simple ways to avoid the deadlocks. First is acquire all the resources before proceeding. First one. And second one is acquire the resources in the same order and release the resources in the reverse order. So this is how we will avoid the deadlock condition. So most kernels allow you to specify a time when acquiring a semaphore. So this features allows a deadlock to be broken. If the semaphore is not available within a certain amount of time, the task requesting the resources resume execution. Some form of error code must be returned to the task to notify it that a timeout occurred. So this is how we will avoid the deadlock. A return error code prevents the task from thinking it has obtained the resource. Now let's move on to the next concept, that is inter-task communication. A task is not aware when a global variable is changed by interrupt service routine until and unless the ISR signal the task by using semaphore. So task will not be aware if the global variable is changed by some ISR. We have discussed in the earlier lecture by giving example of that re-entrant function. So to correct this situation, you should consider either a mailbox or message queue. So let us see what is the mailbox, message mailbox. A message mailbox, also called as message exchange, is a typical a pointer size variable. So through service provided by the kernel, a task or an ISR can deposit a message or the pointer to its mailbox. So this is how the message can be conveyed. Similarly, one or more tasks can receive messages through a service provided by the kernel. Both the sender and receiver task agree on what the pointer is actually pointing to. There are various issues of process communication. So let us see one by one. First issue is no two processes simultaneously in critical section. Second is no assumptions made about speed or numbers of CPU. You cannot make any assumption about the numbers of CPU. No process running outside its critical region may block another process. No process must forever to enter its critical region. And last is proper sequences when process have dependencies upon each other. Next is time management. So the clock tick is a very important part in the time management. सो एक क्लॉक टिक इज ए पीरियडिक टाइम सोर्स टू कीप ट्रैक ऑफ टाइम डिलेज एंड टाइम आउट. सो इट इज व्हाट पीरियडिक टाइम सोर्स. व्हेनेवर ए क्लॉक टिक अकर्स MuCOS इंक्रीमेंट्स ए 32 बिट काउंटर एंड यू नो व्हाट इज 32 बिट. That is the counter starts from 0 to 4294967 means 2 raised to 32 minus 1 tick. So clock t is of 32 bit counter. A task can be delayed and a delayed task can be resumed. So in next slide, in this slide we will discuss more about clock tick. A clock tick is a special interrupt that occurs periodically. This interrupt can be viewed as a system heartbeat. So it is a pulse. The time between interrupt is application specific and is generally between 10 to 200 milliseconds. The clock tick interrupt allow a kernel to delay task for an integral number of clock ticks and to provide timeouts when tasks are waiting for event to occur. The faster the tick rate, the higher the overhead imposed on the system. Because if tick rate is faster, number of task execution and overhead will be increased on system. So next is memory requirement. So in this we will discuss about what type of memory requirement are there in the real-time operating system. So if you are designing a foreground or background system, both are same, foreground background system, the amount of memory required depends solely on your application code. When a multitasking kernel, a kernel requires extra code space, that is RAM, because kernel, we have already discussed, while the task context switching, there are different stacks available for the task 1, task 2, and there are separate memory space related to kernel. So with the multitasking kernel, the kernel always required extra code space. The size of the kernel depends on many factors. It depends on number of features it support. So it can be from 1 KB to 100 KB of memory. A minimal kernel for an 8-bit CPU that provide only scheduling, context switching, semaphore management, delays and timeout should require 1 to 3 kilobytes of code space. So the standard kernel that include scheduling, context switching, semaphore management, delays, timeouts, so that kernel will require 1 to 3 kilobytes of code space memory. So let us see what is the formula for memory requirement. Total code space equals to what application code size plus kernel code size. So total space equals to application code size plus kernel code size, because kernel need extra code space. Each task run independently, it should have separate stack. Obviously every task needs what? Separate stack to store the register values. As a designer, you must determine the requirement of each task, that that task will use this much amount of memory to save the context or to resume the again task. The task must not only account for local variable function calls, but maximum interrupt nesting. So that is important. Maximum interrupt nesting is to save the register and to data retrieve from the register or local store. So there are many advantages and disadvantages of real-time kernel. The real-time operating system RTOS allows real-time application to be designed and expanded easily. The functions can be added without requiring major changes to the software. So this is what the advantage of real-time kernel. The application can be splitted into separate tasks. Obviously, when there are separate tasks, you can assign the priority to each task, and we can handle one by one every task by using kernel. So with a preemptive task, all the tasks are handled effectively and efficiently. So there is priority. RTOS makes better use of resources by providing facilities to such as semaphores, mailbox, queues, time delay, and timeout. So this is what advantages of real-time operating system. So this is the biggest advantage, that RTOS makes better use of shared resources by using this semaphore, mailbox, queues, time delays, and timeouts. Now, the only your application could afford extra requirement, extra RAM, ROM space, and extra overhead of CPU. This is what disadvantage of RTOS, because every kernel need extra code space. So code for program is different and code space required for kernel is different. So RTOS needs extra code space for real-time kernel. The one factor is the most associated with the use of real-time kernel. In some application, cost is everything and would preclude you from even considering an RTOS. Some of these packages include also an I/O manager, windowing system, that is display system, a file system, networking language interface library, and debuggers and cross-platform compilers. RTOS vendors may require extra royalty as per target system basis, so it may also consider maintenance cost. So these are the some disadvantages of real-time kernels. But the biggest advantage is what you can use RTOS in the application where real-time operating system is very needed. So up till now we have discussed various points like concept of deadlock, how that can be avoided, concept of clock tick, memory requirement of real-time operating system, you know, extra memory required to store or to use the kernel, and we have also seen various advantages and disadvantages of real-time kernel. So let's move on to the next video.